Hi everyone, do you hear me that fine?
Yeah,
it's okay.
So, let's have a bit some fun about in-app purchases with Android. So first, quick word about me. Used to be a developer, so I'm not a pen tester. Been working last 10 years in Sudan, coding for security products, and with a strong focus on mobile since 2010. Maybe if you were last year at this, as you show me, I showed an attack on Telegram senior and WhatsApp and comment and all that. I'm also a co-chapter leader at the OWASP Geneva, so I'm really working in application security, AppSec, and I have my own company, and I have people writing, let's say, secure code, let's say, like that. Yeah, there's quite a lot of jobs nowadays with all the first around blockchain and security around that. But for today, I want to show you about what can happen with the Android in-app billing. And we see that it's really not that complex to abuse it and basically get free stuff in-app with that. For that, we will see a bit of Java reverse engineering. How do we write a hook and how do we binary patch the app so that it's working and we get everything for free? And what's most important for me is, yeah, what do we learn from that? What did it happen? Who did things badly? And then what can we do in practice if you want to sell stuff with your Android app out of the and why is this Android in-app stuff not secure the way it's done? So, so what I want to show you, it's always good, you can do apps and whatever with Android applications, but people say, yeah, but does it really matter? It's a game or it's an entertainment, you can get a movie, magazine, whatever, but what's the deal here? So what I tell to my customers and where there is a real impact is, yeah, if you lose money, then they really start listening to you and maybe they push to have some patch done. So that's why when I want to show hacks around Android now, I say, okay, we carry out this inability. Basically, what it does, it's an API, and you develop a game, and you want to make some money out of it, and make more money than with the ads, because the ads really doesn't provide much revenue for that. So you can sell stuff directly from your application. So originally, Apple provided that so that you could subscribe to magazine. And then basically Google copied that. And then people start with this feature to sell premium features. Let's say you have some features you don't have access with the free app, and then if you pay, you get those hidden features. And now it's mostly used by games where you can free games like Candy Crush, and then at one point you're stuck in the game and you need to buy bonus or extra life or whatever to be able to continue. There's a guy in Dubai, he spent like $20,000 to have his best castle or whatever. So some people really buy with this app, and some apps can make millions of revenue per year with this in-app purchase. So there's real money at stake here. And what Google says, it's good for developers because from the app, you don't have to handle the payment yourself. So everything is on Google side, they manage the credit card and they should be doing the security. So as a developer, you don't have this PCI DSS stuff to worry about and should be nice. You have long documents available at Google. Like basically all the Android dev guides, they are really, really badly maintained, not up to date, difficult to follow whatsoever. So this diagram is really ugly, I see. Even when I know it, I have to reread it again and again to understand what's happening. This is the only diagram available in those 20 pages of documents, and it's not up to date, so it doesn't match the current protocol. Lots of exchanges, basically, what you have to understand with that. First, diagram is bad because it misses some steps. So here, it's your application, your Android game. Here, it's the Google Play application that is running on your Android phone. So if you want to use this feature, you need to have Google Play. And then what does this Google Play app? It will forward that to Google server. That they should have shown here, because otherwise you don't know what's happening. This is most likely configuration stuff. We don't really care, but at some point you say, hey, I want to buy something. The Google Play app say, hey, this is the ID of the stuff you are trying to buy. And then you say, yeah, I really want to buy that. Then Google Play app takes control on it, and I will show you just after. It displays a pop-up where you choose your credit card, whatever, you pay. And then in response, the Google Play app wakes up your Android app and says, yeah, here is what the guy just bought. So he just bought this, what they call an SKU, which is basically an ID of the object he bought. And then you have a signature to prove that it's really the user that did it and that Google confirmed, so proving that you're not cheating. So this signature is going to be really important. So what would be the target? Well, first I wanted to target things like Angry Birds, really popular, but they did it not so badly. So we will have a look at the end and what they did and how they have addressed it correctly, let's say. So a few years ago, there was a game that was like on the top 10, didn't last, that was Panda Pop, some kind of pseudo Tetris like whatever, but on that or whatever. And then with that, you can buy new weapons and extra lives. So basically, you have levels. And at some point, the level is so insane, you can't win by yourself, you need to buy extra credit. And they hope that maybe 1% of users get addicted and then pay for that. So first thing I did, I downloaded the game directly from the website, and I would run it in an emulator. So yeah, be careful when you download those kind of Chinese websites, you get lots of extra features in the app. Run it in an emulator. So first thing I use for the emulator, I use Genymotion, which is free for research. It's really fast, much faster than the emulator provided in Android Studio. And what's really nice is, yeah, you want to boot the device, you just click once and then it gets rooted, which is really useful. And then you have to install Google Play on it, because by default Genymotion is their own ROM, so they don't have everything. So you have to click a little and install Google Play. So there are some, the guys from GAPS produce the Google Play installation file so that you can put it. Then the first thing I would show you, we take the game and we will reverse it and see what's inside. So basically these two JEDEX will take the APK file, which is basically a zip file, and transform it to readable Java source code if it can. So it's not totally the original Java source code, but it's source code that will produce the same bytecode in the end. And then what we will do, well, I will show you just after, we will look at a special class or an interface that's called in-app billing service, which is in all those, you know, Google Documents, Quantic Pages of Docs. There's something that's really interesting there. They have some ProGuard recommendations. So ProGuard is to rename classes to make it more difficult to do reverse engineering. And they say, hey, if you are using our feature, you should tell ProGuard to do not touch anything about Android vending billing, because otherwise it would mess up the thing, or the class loading would not work whatsoever. So what it means that, hey, you are sure that in any Android app that will be using this feature, you just have to look for that and you will find it in clear. Because otherwise the feature doesn't work. So they have to not obfuscate that, which is a really cool entry point. So for that, I will just show you JEDEX, what it looks like. So you launch JEDEX, it's either command line or it's GUI. You just open your APK file. It will take some time for processing. So meanwhile, it takes about 2 minutes to do the decompilation. So meanwhile, I will show you the next slide. So you see just after. So with this editor, you will see that the guys that developed PandaPop, they didn't obfuscate anything. So I was just looking for I in a billing service, but I saw that if I everything was in C or Java, so you could see everything. So you start to search everywhere where there is I in a building service, and then you look to the classes, and then maybe two or three classes after, there's something that I find totally fascinating. So there is a method that's called Precious Project, so it sounds good. That's a class that's called Google IAB plugin for in-app building project. But this code is not from Google, you see, it's from guys that are called Prime 31. So clearly it's custom made code, and in the middle of it, you have some special case and you have a log entry. And this log entry for me is smells so bad. First, you have log entries in the production app, so debug logs. So why do you have debug logs in this production app? So it's kind of crazy. So basically, you know that those guys don't know what they are doing because everything in clear Java, and then you still have a log message. And what's a log message? Fixing Google bug. So the guys that developed that thought there was a bug in the Google feature, and they fixed it by himself, probably. And he put it in comment, but instead of putting it in comments in the source code, he directly put a log entry and let it in the production code. So for me, it's, And what is this special case? It's looking for a special value that is under it.test.purchase. So what do you do with that? Well, you just Google the special value, and what you find in the middle of those 20 pages of Google Docs, you see that under it.test.purchase, what it means? Well, Google Play will respond you as though you successfully purchased an item. So it's a test value that says, yeah, you paid for it, but in fact, you don't have to pay for it. It's working, so I will show you Jadix now. So clearly, with that, you know how it smells really bad, so we'll have some fun and we'll try to fraud these values. So I will show you Jadix. So. Here, what's really cool, you see, it's really, in a few minutes, it really found out all the Java source code additives, whatever, and as a super cool feature, you can export all that to an Android Studio project. Then you open your Android Studio and you can do all the replay search you want and even debug. Now we see that they do a special case for this test value, and they do something strange. Let's force this value. So what we are going to do, we are going to write a hook. So basically, we will be overloading the Android app with new code, so that at the beginning of the purchase product method, we will force the SKU instead of saying, I buy like extra weapon one, I say, I'll buy Android.test.purchase, and we see what happens. So to be able to write a hook, you can use the Expose framework. So what is the Expose framework? It's a software that you install on your Android device. So I really suggest you don't do it on your personal smartphone because you can rip it. I even broke my virtual machine yesterday, so I was really glad I had Dailymotion and I could set up a new one quickly. So what it does, it's changes the behavior of the Java class loader on your Android phone. So instead of, let's say, loading the class Toto, it will load your own version of your class Toto. So it all happens at runtime, so you don't have to recompile the application. You just give at runtime a new implementation of it, which is really powerful. And to do that, well, you code the hook with Android Studio, and you build a new APK file. So it's like really a totally different app, but that will overload the original app. So you keep your original game and you just write a few lines of Java to get new behavior on top of your other app. So to be able to do that, I told you, you need a rooted device because to change the Android class, Java class loader, you need to be root. So that's why I use an emulator to do so. And then to install the hooking framework, it's easy. You have an APK, if you're root, drag and drop, and then that's finished. What it looks like, I will show you directly in Android Studio. don't see one, I guess. Don't know how to include it. So. Because what you have to do, you will have a slide afterwards if you don't see one. Basically, you have a hook method and you say that I'm looking for the method that's called purchase product, that's waiting for two screens in parameters. And what I'm doing there, I implemented the before hooked method. So I say that before the real method is executed, I will first do this Java code before. So here I'm just taking parameter 1, 2, logging them, and then just what I'm saying is, yeah, I'm replacing the first parameter, which is a product I want to buy, with Android.test.purchase. So in the end, you can just write line of Java, and then we see what happens with that. So I will build it. So you build it like a general Android app. Meanwhile, I will show you in practice how that it looks like when you do an in-app purchase. So without hooking, without cheating, and then we will deploy the hook and you see the difference. So I'm loading this game. So it's rather slow because with the emulator, you don't get full speed. Okay, well, there's this point today, well, we don't care. Okay. So, normally in this game, you are here and you can buy some extra coins. Let's say you want 35 extra coins, so it's in Swiss franc because my Google account is in Switzerland. I click on it. And then you see something happening, then you get a pop-up. And the pop-up that you see here, you see it's written Google Play. So you're not anymore in your Android game, you are on Google Play. And then if you click continue, you will have to pay for it, and here it tells you, yeah, well, this is this price. So what I do, I cancel. Well, it's not happy. Here. Okay, I kill that. So in the meantime, my hook was compiled. So what I do, and this is really cool with Jellymotion, so when you need to install an application, you just need to drag and drop. So the hook has been installed, but now there's a trick. It says, well, it's not activated. So I install my hook, I have to activate it. But then it tells me, yeah, I have to reboot. Why? Because there you are working really low in the Java virtual machine, and you have to know that many of the features of the Android system are already written in Java, like the GUI and all that stuff. So you cannot deploy that in real time because you could really cut the branch where you're sitting. So like, you know, sometimes you want to do all deploy in Java on server, it's not working, you have to restart it. So you have to restart each time you deploy a new version of the hook, you have to restart your device. So that's why you need an emulator that's not that slow. So I will restart it. And then we see what happens. Here we are, I check everything is deployed. Yeah, and now. Let's check. Always risky to do a demo. So. Well, it's been working for more than 1 year. I teach that to some students and they use that when they want to start reverse engineering. So I say, I want to buy some stuff. I click on it. Boom. What do you see there? Sample title. Now it's not anymore on Swiss franc. It's in dollar. And you see, Visa XXS page. So now Google Play, the Google application, is telling, yeah, you're going to buy something with a fake card, a credit card. And what do you do? Well, now I say, click buy. Well, successful from Google, okay, that's fine. And then again, yeah, I got my code. Okay, so free purchase now. So, why? That's really the important question. So you saw the notes and whatever, so why? Well, what Google says in their documentation with this special test value, if you use this value, you don't get any signature in the answer. So they say, yeah, okay, it's successful, but they don't provide a signature, so you have a return code that says, well, it's not really bugged, but you have something. So let's have a look at the source code and understand why it's working. So you dig a little further with the addict in the source code and you find another class. And all stays in one line, and you have one line that basically says, yeah, do I want to call security.verifyPurchase? But there's a special case that says, yeah, but if my purchase is a test SKU, basically it bypasses the signature validation. And what is a test SKU? Yeah, it starts with Android.test. So why does it work? Well, two reasons. First, Google accepts its test value, and the developer that wrote this code from Prime31, well, he let test conditions in production code, which is just stupid. So, well, it's working. So you're happy, you can enjoy your free game, but still you're on the emulator, so yeah, it's not that convenient. So now you say you want to give that to your family so that they play with free games with it. So what we are going to do, we are going to do bytecode patching. So, we will take the original APK file and we in it try to change just this line of code in the method so that it does it automatically. So for that, the Android app is not directly Java bytecode, it's Pali bytecode, so they have an intermediate language inside. But they have tools so that you can edit it. So, but you can read it, but it's really not nice to write it. So what I do in practice, I take the original game and I generate the smallie of it. I take my hook, I generate the smallie of it also. And then I just copy paste what's in my hook and I inject it just in the line that I want. And then I rebuild the original game with this change. And then I will show you also what I do. And then we get hopefully the game that's working and that you can distribute to anyone. So to do so, to convert to smallie, you can run this command. And then I will show you that I will do the scripts and then we comment meanwhile. So, I will copy this line. So what this line means, basically you are converting your original game to smallie code. This one is rather fast normally. Okay, it's done. Then what I do, I know where my class is. I know what I have to patch because I saw in Jadix that it was this class that had this Android.test.purchase bug. So I go in the source file and I edit. The smiley code of the class I want. So here, this is Smallie. So how does it look like? So I search in Smallie for the method that called purchase product, and in it, you see it's kind of where language is. You have a method that's called purchase product. It's taking input two strings, whatever. So yeah, you don't want to write it, it's kind of low level code, but you understand somehow what's happening. You have a first parameter that's called SKU, another parameter that's called developer payload, you have the name of the method and whatever, and then you have a prolog, which is the beginning of the method. So just to easily, if you remember, we did a before hook method, so I will just inject my code at the beginning of the prolog. And so for that, what am I going to inject? I'm going to inject that. So how do I know I have to write that? Well, if you take the hook you wrote and you also do the smiley on it, you see that the line you want is that. So I just insert this line. I insert my line. You have to be careful with the spaces. Okay. So now what we're gonna do, now we change the smiley, so now we take the smiley and compile it back again and put it in the APK file. So we will rebuild the APK file with this new binary code. So for that, normally you just have to launch a command. We did from APK to smiley, there's the same command to do smiley to APK, so it should be easy, but in practice, the tools used, APK tool and Smiley, they just take care about the Java part, but because it's a game and you have lots of graphic rendering, in the APK file, you also have C libraries for all the graphics engine. And by default, those tools that are able to repackage Android apps, you will lose those C libraries, and of course the game will not be working. So you have to tweak a little, but so I create a copy of my original file. So there, first, what I do, I recompile the Smiley files to a new file that's called classes.dex. So in an APK file, all the Java compile code ends in this file, which is classes.dex. And then I just play manually with zip commands, because an APK file is a zip file, to just modify to update this classes.dex file in the APK. That's the only thing I do. Okay, that's fine now. So now I've patched my Android app, but if you try to install it, it won't work because you have a signature on Android app, and if you deploy it, well, it says, well, it's not working. Signature of this app is broken. So first thing you do, well, you shoot the signature from the APK file, so you just do a delete in the zip file of the signature, and then this is the magic, you will sign it with your name, whatever you want. So first you generate a key, so whatever you want, so I'm creating a key and I put whatever name in it. So I will sign the application as dummy, 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 whatever. Yes, I'm sure I'm dummy, 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 yeah. Okay, so now what I do, because an Android signature is in fact just for this version, it's just a Java signature as standard, I just call jar signer and I say I use the key I just generated before. And of course
you need the other line also.
Ah, yeah, the note. Thank you. So I will be signing the APK file with the key I just created. So it's resigning everything now. Okay. So you see, there are some SO libraries. Those are the C libraries that are used for graphics. So now we recomputed everything, and then what I do, I will start a new virtual machine. So on the demo I showed before with Expose, I was in an Android 5.1. Now I'll show you with a newest Android 6. This new virtual machine I am starting, you don't have Expose on top of it, it's not rooted, whatever. So it's really a device, if someone is interested, it comes with an Android device, and we can deploy it as is. So it's a real standard device now that I'm starting. And I will install in it the new APK file we built, which is called PandaPop Patch. Some bugs with the free version sometimes of the motion. Sometimes it doesn't hurt. Yeah, I know I didn't migrate it, and because it's a free version, you can migrate it. So I let it start. So I just sum up what we did, and I'll show you that it's working. So what we did, so we did from APK to Smally, we changed it, we repacked the new Smally in a we combined it in a classic index, we zip it to update the file, and then we resign it. So here is what we did, on that, then we resign it, and we deploy, and it's gonna work. And the application I show, we can be even more nasty. I can now publish it on the Play Store. If I want, and I can try to sell it and say, I sell it for $5 and say, this is a PandaPop plus application where you get everything for free. And if no one complains, so basically the editor is not complaining because he doesn't see it, I can make some money. Maybe at some point someone catches me, but it won't be Google because they are not doing active monitoring for that. And what will happen, they will just shoot my Gmail account behind and maybe say to Visa or MasterCard that all the money I get that's linked to this credit card that they have to cancel it. So, but most of the time, you can try it and you can make some easy money with it. Okay, so it's loaded. So now, this is a new device. So while it's deploying, let's discuss about that. So why did it happen? Why does it work? It shouldn't. It seems too obvious. Well, first we saw that there was debug code in production app. So this is just crazy. So never let special test value in your code. And when you do a build, you have a release build, and it should not happen. You should not have log file or test get in it. But what I want to stress, really, Google, they failed their design. How come you accept in production for a real app on the Google Play Store that you can send a test value with it and then it will return, successful, but you didn't pay. Maybe you can have some sandbox environment or whatever when you say, okay, you want to test your features, you can. But as soon as the app is published on the official Play Store, this value should not work. This is just some design. So for me, Google is really responsible for that. unless something else bigger, I'll say, okay, the application is responsible for checking the signature. So it means that in the Java source code, you have to say, yeah, I call verify signature. I played with Android.tezos purchase, but I could have done something else. I could just have, in the security verify purchase, change the implementation and say it become true, and then it would have worked. So, and Google is somehow aware of it. So, if you have a look at what they call their best practices, they say, yeah, when you are validating your purchase, they say, it is highly recommended, and this is in bold, but in the middle of 20 pages, to validate purchase details on a server that you trust, so not inside your Android app. But if you cannot use the server, yeah, come on today, you can't use the server, you can rent it on Amazon or something on Heroku, it is still to validate these details within your app. So let's say you tell your project manager, yeah, we don't have a server, it's not going to be secure, and say, ah, come on, Google says it's still somehow okay, so yeah. Let's do it like that. So that's a joke. But if you have a look at more details below, you say, okay, if you have to validate it on your Android device, it says, warning, this form of verification isn't truly secure because basically because you can hook it. And then what's our advice? Well, do some obfuscation with ProGuard. But on another page, you saw that they say, yeah, you cannot obfuscate those names because otherwise, it's not going to work. So it's a bit of a joke. But for me, what's worse, and this is really the key message you have to keep here, you can't use this feature to buy credit. Originally, Apple did it to have a subscription to magazines. So when you subscribe to a magazine, basically, you are downloading data that you cannot invent. You are buying real content with a credit or whatever. You are just incrementing a counter, so it's totally predictable. So you know that if you buy 50 gold points, you have plus 50 on the gold point counter, and that's it. So you're not buying something that has real value. It's just plus one. So because of that, whatever you do, you will be able to hook your application or to do bytecode patching to just modify the counter, and that's finished. So by design, you can't use in-app billing to do that. But on other pages, Google documentation, they give example of why to use that feature, what's cool with it, and what they say, hey, the users in game character might gain life points or gain extra gold points in their inventory. So if you read that from Google, say, yeah, I'm totally fine. If I do that with a server, I'm totally safe. Push your notes. So I show you the game. Just to prove that it's working, and then we finish. So it's here. So real Android device now. So this is first time you play, you have this crappy introduction that explains you how to play, yeah. So you got it, huh? I didn't write a hook to bypass this info. I should have. Blah, 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 whatever. Okay, so yeah, we are saving all the pandas. Yeah, that's it, yeah, wow. Super cool, whatever. Yeah. Yeah, wow. Yeah. That's why you need a fast emulator. Then whatever, share on Facebook, under your friends, whatever. Yeah, next. And then now. Okay, for level 2, I say, yeah, I want to buy some stuff. Yeah, let's buy the... Yeah, it's another Google account that's in Euro, so that's why you see Euro there. Okay, let's buy the, yeah, like 4,000 points, yeah. Let's get it. And as before, directly in the APK file, you get it. I buy it, and it's gonna work. So now I can just log in to Google Play, become an app developer, and then, yeah, sell it from there. Okay. But, yeah. Of course, I need some responsible disclosure with that. I won't be showing it like that and being filmed on YouTube and whatever with that. I'm not that crazy. So first, I contacted the game editor of PandaPop. Like, they do some kind of those games, and they make millions per year. I couldn't never add an answer for them, so just they don't care. if they made millions with Spanakop or thousands of dollars with it and they don't want to patch, okay? But I was most interested with Prime 31. Because when you see the packaging, you see clearly that some has been written by the company behind Pandacop, but some is from another company. So what is Prime 31? When you have a look at it, they wrote the Android in-app purchase integration, but the one with the protest and whatever. So yeah, I use their ticketing tool and say, yeah, I found a vulnerability in your thing, and I think it's annoying because, yeah, you can steal content and you are selling a plugin to sell content. I got a quick feedback, like the next day I got an answer from someone from there. He said, yeah, this vulnerability doesn't make any sense. Yeah, well, it's up to you. The developer should be checking the SKU of the purchase project. So yeah, I was a bit pissed off because he didn't listen to me. So what I did, I said, okay. Because he didn't want to answer to my question, I said, okay, so now I buy your plugin. $70, I buy it, and then I'm a customer, and you answer my questions. So I got this plugin, so basically this game is using Unity. Unity is something like you work games in C#, and then there's a cross-compiler that can produce you an iPhone game, an Apple game, a JavaScript game, or whatever. So basically their plugin is a C# wrapper between Android and the Unity engine. So, and now, as this guy promised me, I'm a customer, so I should be receiving the full integration docs with all the best guidelines and whatever. Oh well, the developer doc is a joke. It's just a link to their basic website. So yeah. So they are not providing any real doc. It's just like crappy tutorial. And if I found the URL before, I could have it for free. And in the middle of it, there's something that's really interesting that says, Google IU recommends to validate purchase on the secure server. The plugin will do on-device validation for you, but Android apps are very easily hacked, so this should not be relied on. So once you bought it, they give you a URL to dog that say, yeah, in fact, yeah, it's crap. Well, that's really stupid. The API of their plugin, it can support external verification on the server. But the C# demo they provide does not use it, so you don't have a clue as a standard developer that you should do so. So round three, I send those slides to be sure that I can talk about it. And then I got quick feedback again. I said, yeah, excellent, yeah, many thanks. Look forward to meeting them today, which was months before, and then nothing. And of course, as a customer, I don't get any fix in this library, so all the current customers, they can be attacked. So if you want to be nasty, you download that many APKs from those Chinese websites, you look for this class name, and then you get automatically patched them. And then that's all. Well, I think the business impact is rather good. So yeah, so what do you have to do in practice now? Well, step zero, recommendation of Google, you use ProGuard. So ProGuard will basically rename classes and mingle stuff, so you will lose some time trying to do so, but it won't be a good protection. The Android in-app classes can't be protected, so you have your entry point and then it's easy to follow what will happen. First thing you can do a bit to really slow down an attacker, with Android you can use a native development kit, NDK, so that you can embed C logic. So what you can do, all those verification of signature and integration, you can write it in C code and then if someone has to reverse it, he has to know how to reverse IRF binary, which is a bit more difficult. So you can do so. You can also, step two, do what Google says should be done. You use an external backend to validate the signature so that you do the purchase, you get the answer from Google Play in your app, and this answer, you post it to your server, and so the verification code is on the server, so a hacker cannot easily change it. But then the issue with that is the server will say yes or no, this signature is valid. So the only thing you have to do, you have to have a hook that says on server response, says yes, everything happened fine. So it's still a joke because you can bypass it easily. So what can you do in the end? Well, it's a lesson learned. You can only sell real content with it. You can only sell content that's not predictable. You cannot sell something that will increment a counter. So let's just have a look at what Angry Birds does. So what Angry Birds do, of course, they have Frogger. All the in-app buying, it's in C-code. And what Angry Birds is selling, they are not selling extra birds, extra lights or whatever. They are selling new levels. So clearly you are buying an extension where you have a gameplay and levels and whatever. Something you cannot design easily by yourself. So you are really buying real content. So how does it look like in practice? So if you take Jadix with Angry Birds and you have to try a look at it, we have, for example, a method that's called payment finish, and you get no implementation in it. You just have the magic keyword netting. So what it means? It means that all the logic is in the C library, and then you have to reverse the C library, which is more complex. And there are lots of things like that. So Android, yeah, I've done something that's meaningful, Angry Birds 3, to protect against it. So they have some stuff hidden in the C library. They do the validation on their backend, and you are buying some real content, so you cannot predict it. So if you want to hack that, you will now, take it to succeed. So so as a conclusion, I hope you saw that doing Java reverse engineering of Android app is really easy. Open in Jadix, and then you get the Java code, that's it. What it means is that you cannot trust at all the Java code in your Android app. So often I see with customers, sometimes it's mobile banking, and then you get like host token in the Java source code. And they saw that the API is protected for that because it should be a secret token, and you see that in the app it's written secret token. But it's not secret at all. And you saw that it's really not difficult to binary patch an Android app, and then you can resign it. So modifying it, it's really not difficult. So only thing you can trust is your server code, which, And then, I hope I convince you that Google, they are totally misleading in their recommendations for that. By reading it, you can think that, if I check it locally, it's somehow okay, and if I do it on the backend, I'm super safe. It's really not the case, and they even advertise some use cases that by design you cannot secure. So for me, it's really, really bad job for them to have done that. So for me, they just made a pale copy of what Apple was proposing for in-app purchases, and they say, we should deliver something quickly. We make money out of it, and if there are 1 or 2% of people that are hacking with that, we don't really care. And then bonus point for the ones that want to talk to me afterwards. With Android Studio, you can even debug your app full time if you do things nicely. You sign the application with the debug permission, and then you get real live breakpoints in it. And then there's a new signature scheme on Android 7, but for compatibility reasons, you still have to keep the signature with the before, so it's still possible to bypass. So, and if you want to go to Switzerland next week for another great security conference, just go. Thank you.
Ask questions? No?
Yeah.
Here's the mic.
Hi. Because there is someone that has this vulnerable app available on the Play Store, someone downloads, someone creates a patch, it's out there in the wild. What can the company create the game or the app stop someone basically gaining access to free credits?
The only thing they can do is, they have to monitor the Google Play Store and then say to Google, this is a fake app, this is a clone, and you have to remove it.
What happens if it's not on the Play Store, some website or it's something, someone already has it, so...
Yeah, but it's too late.
No, there's no solution.
Okay. And as you know, for mobile banking, it's a really short. You saw that last week, even WhatsApp, there was a copy of it, and basically they just did this script. You take your WhatsApp, you add whatever malware feature in it or you want, and then you republish it, and you have some bots that create, like, we use 5 times, this app is so cool, whatever, then you get on top of the Play Store, and people that don't really want their first download your app.
Okay, so, great talk.
Thanks.
Anyone else? No? Yes, that is. Thank you.